I've heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? Well, it goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing, hallelujah.
This isn't church, so those of you who are in the back, if you'd like to get up front, you could too. It's fine. Join us. On behalf of Michael's family, I thank you for being present at this celebration of a very, very special, special life. We've come together acknowledging our human loss. But through our tears, we celebrate the life of Big Mac Daddy. Cheers. Big Mac Daddy. How can you forget a name like that? Well, you couldn't, because Michael would make sure that you remembered it. So I may slip and say Michael, but you know, he's Big Mac Daddy. We look for God to grant us grace, that in pain we find comfort, in sorrow we find hope, and in death we realize the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the promise that he made to us all for the same. Let us pray. Almighty and loving Father, we've gathered this day to celebrate the life of Michael. Open our minds and our hearts to receive the power of your strength, the power of your comfort, the power of your courage. Give us that peace within us that through our faith you have already received Michael's soul into your loving arms and have spread your wings of grace and mercy upon him. In the name of your risen Christ, we say, Amen.
Some of you may not know me, but we're all here for Michael. My name is Kevin. I was a close friend of his, and he took good care of me. And I hope that I took good care of him too. You see, Michael was many things to many people. He was a loving son. He was the comedic relief of any stressful situation. He was a dependable coworker. He was a devoted friend. He was a compassionate companion. And he was one of the biggest shit talkers I have ever met. And to that guy at Lowe's home improvement store who was loudly abusing a defenseless employee just for doing her job, he was her knight in shining armor, riding in on a wheelchair clad with oxygen tank, who calmly informed this abusive gentleman that, "Sir, you are a garbage human being." It feels cheap to distill who Michael was into a speech that probably won't last more than 15 minutes. Capturing who Michael was can't really be done that way, so I won't try to. Instead, I want to share who I knew Michael to be, things he has taught me, and ways in which my life is enriched for having had him. March 18th, 2014. It was 11 p.m. It was a Tuesday night. The weather was nice. I went for what would be a fateful motorcycle ride. I ended up going wide in a corner on one of my favorite roads. It was covered in trees, like a canopy. I slid and I went flipping into the trees and off the side of the road. And when I crawled up, full of adrenaline, largely okay, Michael had seen me and he circled back to make sure that I, a total stranger, was okay. That night, he drove me home, he made sure I was safe, and he towed my wrecked motorcycle out of a ditch and into my driveway on his own dime. Once he was sure that I was okay, he was ready to drive off into the night. Maybe glad I could help. See, of course, I didn't let him. I wouldn't be in front of you today if I had. I made him give me his number, and I forced him to go to dinner with me. See, he had to be forced to go to dinner because in his mind, he didn't do anything that warranted earning a free dinner. He just did a good deed purely out of the kindness of his heart, for the sake of doing the right thing. I later learned that he did this frequently. In fact, most of the reason why he got a AAA membership in the first place was to get that free towing. We called him the Tow Fairy. And of course, that's Big Mac Daddy the Tow Fairy. His intention was to help a stranger, plain and simple. He would stop for stranded motorists, help friends out when their cars broke down, and he did it all the time. And that brings me to the first lesson that Michael taught me, is to be kind to others purely for the sake of being kind. The world is wild, unfair, unpredictable. It pulls no punches. But do you want to leave a legacy worth talking about? Just be kind and expect nothing in return. We're all in this together. From the beginning of our friendship, as I was getting to know Michael, it was clear that this guy was not like anyone I had ever met before. Not even a little bit. We'd have fun with our motorcycle adventures, food outings, board game nights, late night mechanic projects, whether it was my bike or his car or his bike. We were always doing something. And we just loved hanging out. You see, we shared this certain irreverent humor. And as anyone close to him knows, he would never miss an opportunity for a well-placed "your mom" joke, regardless of the environment or how appropriate it was. Mischievous at heart, he would always be scheming new ways to harmlessly fluster or prank his friends. And through all the attitude, the relentless jokes, and the friendly teasing, he taught me the second lesson, that humor is the best defense against taking life too seriously. There are endless things to be upset by. There are endlessly serious things to look at in life. To the point that if we should give in to those things fully, we may never recover. There's always something. So laugh at a fart joke once in a while. He was cruelly saddled with a debilitating illness, one which eventually claimed his life and took him from us far sooner than we were ready to say goodbye. But right up to his last few days with us, he was teasing us and finding something funny to share with the nurses. And this humor allowed his spirit to shine through the challenges, the ailments, his discomfort. So always make sure that your sense of humor is well within reach. Now, Michael knew when to pause on the pranks and reel in the humor. He knew when a friend was in need. In my case, he often knew when I was having a hard time, far before I ever really did. He would ask honestly, "What's going on?" And he would be there to listen. In my darkest times, he was there for me in ways that made me really question whether I deserved to have a friend of that kind or not. Truly, he was a light in my darkness. I learned how to be more aware of when there's a friend in need, and how to be the light for someone else through their darkness. Now, a few weeks before he took a turn and ended up in the ICU, a few of us friends got together at the hospital with him for pizza and board games. We had an absolute blast, even if it was just for the evening. Things felt normal. Things felt great. He was his normal, playful self, teasing us and hitting us with some, frankly, pretty brilliant board game strategies. Sharp as ever. Everything was like it used to be. He didn't seem as exhausted as he had been. He was vibrant. And for a moment, it felt hopeful. Even if we knew the situation he was in, we knew that it was oppressive. That's the thing about being friends with Michael. It was a relationship that was likely to end in the loss of a dear friend. And that leads me to the final lesson that I'd like to share. Allow yourself to be vulnerable to meaningful experiences. Let yourself love people fully, even if the journey is guaranteed to be painful. It's often these experiences, the ones that hurt us the most, which help us define who we are, grow in ways that we never would have imagined we could. And sometimes it's the toughest, most painful experiences that we look back on and realize that we would trade them for nothing. Now, like I said, I've never met anyone like Michael, and I don't think I can ever expect to. Losing him has left a crater in me, and it hurts in a whole new way. So I get it. I understand the tears. But Michael didn't want so many tears at his service. What he wanted was a celebration of life. And how fitting is that? One of the strongest people I've ever met, who's experienced so much between skydiving, racing a motorcycle at the racetrack, being an Eagle Scout. Put all of these lessons together, and a theme emerges that life is painful. Life is joyous. Life is everything in between. And no matter what, life is beautiful in all its forms. And it is to be lived. It takes all of those parts to truly be alive, to experience purpose, fulfillment. And what better way to do that than to allow yourself to be vulnerable to the experiences, to that love? To let humor be the tool that gets you through, that strengthens you. To check in on people that you care about. To be the light in their darkness. Be selflessly kind. And don't ever pass up the opportunity to drop a fart joke when it's entirely inappropriate. Now, I'm not going to say that Michael was a blessing to us all, because of course he was a blessing to us. I'm not going to say Michael's love for his friends knew no bounds. It certainly didn't seem to, but those things are all true and can be said about him. But it can't be left at that. That doesn't tell the whole story. It tells my story. And it's important to tell the whole story. He believed that the whole story is something that can be held by everyone as truth. So please, let's keep it about Michael Let's stick to your experiences. A story that you shared with him. Something that you'd like to share with him. Maybe something that you learned from him. So that we might all get the whole story of who Michael Macaluso was. If anybody would like to share, the mic is open for you.
So very few of you actually know me. My name is Matt. I am also an Eagle Scout, thanks to Michael. I knew this was gonna be hard. I didn't know it was gonna be this hard. I came into Troop 48 when I was in the fifth grade. I wasn't even technically a Boy Scout yet when one of my best friends went over there. I showed up and Michael was like, what do you need to do? What requirements do you need to do to join us? He didn't worry about his requirements. He didn't worry about his time. He made sure that I got through it. He's the reason why me plus four other young men became Eagle Scouts. His time with the troop was very short during when I showed up, because when I was entering, he was exiting, but I knew that because of him, I wanted to become an Eagle Scout as well. And that is why I worked very hard to follow his footsteps in the Eagle Scout tradition. And just on the behalf of Troop 48, and the rest of scouting itself, we will miss you very much, Michael.
Thank you. Anyone else?
A lot of you guys don't know me either. I'm Marissa. I actually got to meet Michael because my sister and he worked together at Walgreens, I think in Cedar Park or Leander, like in 2009 and 2010. And so he was at our house all the time, every day, and he became like a little brother to me. And so when my sister moved away, we still maintained that friendship. And we ended up becoming roommates. He was such a great friend. He's like a little brother to me, and I just care so much about him. He was there for me through a lot in terms of just, you know, work growth, life growth, and just when I got married, having children, and he's been there for me in terms of getting to be supportive of my family and myself. I just remember a lot of the times when we were roommates, he just made us laugh all of the time, constantly. I think someone mentioned making, practical jokes. He was constantly like moving books around on my bookshelf, and I wouldn't always notice it until like I'd start looking for it. And I would notice that he'd moved like a significant amount of books, and I'm like, this must have taken him a while. And of course I'm oblivious until I start looking, and I thought, he put a lot of work into this. We would, stay up late watching movies and cooking pancakes at 2 a.m., just having a lot of fun together. And I'm glad that he was just, that I got to be a part of his life, and he was just really such a good friend. And I can't even put into words all of the fun times that we had and just how much he meant to me and my family and to my sister as well, and to my husband and even to my five-year-old. But we love him dearly, and we're so sorry that he did not, that this is how we had to say goodbye to him, but we're just so grateful that we got to have all of this time with him. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hey guys, I'm gonna try and keep it together. Michael and I go back pretty much to middle school when we, Susie had her house on, has her house on Girona. It's probably about the eighth grade. Started taking the bus to school. That's when I first met Michael. He lived about five doors down from me, and first day we met was getting off that school bus, and I was relieved to find out there's another kid my age on my block. And so we started hanging out, starting to get to know each other after school. And one of my favorite memories is our bus driver, his name was Doug. And there was a certain route on our trip home through one of the neighborhoods where it had like this massive bump in the street. And, you know, Doug would, as we were driving, he'd slow down, kind of hit the bump, and then keep going. And after about a month and a half, every time he'd come up to that bump, Michael and I would yell out, "Come on, Doug, don't be a dork, hit that thing." And so it took about a week and a half, but every single day, he'd hit that bump a little bit harder and harder, and complete disregard for the other kids on the rest of the bus, and it was awesome. And so we started sitting right on the rear wheel well, and finally, about halfway through the year, we got Doug the courage to really hit that bump, and I remember one day, we were coming up to it, and we were like, Doug. And man, I tell you, he floored that bump and our heads hit the roof of that school bus. And all the other kids, like half the kids turned around and just glared at us. And Michael gave his proverbial salute to the kids. And so that was later on in the school year, I used to fall asleep on the bus home. And I remember one day I woke up and I was the last kid on the bus and we'd already passed my bus stop. And I was like, the hell? And I finally, you know, had to call my parents. They came, Doug swung back around, dropped me off and he goes, "I didn't even see you were back there." And I go, "Well, Michael usually wakes me up." And he goes, "Oh." I asked Michael when he was walking off and he's like, "Yeah, he's not here today." Yep. I was pretty angry at him that day. Talked to him the next day, and I was like, "So you're just not gonna wake me up?" And he goes, "You fell asleep, jackass." So that's when I knew this kid was gonna be a friend for life. So many, many more memories were shared after that moment, and I will cherish every one of them. Thank you.
We have time for one more.
There you go, come on. I know not a lot of people may know me, but my name's C. I've known Michael since middle school. And he's kind of taught me a lot about life. So I have a couple little stories for you here. One of the story was when, I think this was about when we were in eighth grade. And I remember he had this crush on this girl. And so he didn't tell me why, but he was like, "Hey, let's hang out at my house." So we're hanging out at his house and he decided to give Puppet John a call. And I was like, okay. And he used an iMac so that he didn't have to verbally say what he wanted, but he ordered this pizza that had pineapple and anchovies on it. And I was like, why would you order that pizza? And he's like, oh no, that's not for us. I'm sending this to this girl that I like. And I was like, why would you do that? And he's like, like it's to get her attention, I guess. And I was just like, okay. So, I mean, I personally was like, I don't think that's gonna work, which I don't think it did work, but it definitely got her attention. And like, she was just like, stop bothering me. Like, why are you doing this? I'm getting a weekly pizza of pineapple and anchovies all the time. I'm like, please stop. And so I think he stopped. Later on, I remember making this trip to San Antonio with him. At this time he had a blue Honda. And he said that he hated this car. And I was like, why? Like, this car looks pretty new and whatnot. He hated it because on the passenger side, there was an airbag sensor, which unfortunately for Michael, because of how light he was, he would plenty of times would not set it off. So it would act like there's nobody sitting there. And so Michael's like, yeah, I'm kind of afraid for my life sitting in the passenger seat because apparently I don't weigh enough to set off the sensor. And so, you know, he was able to kind of make fun of himself. And then I'm going to fast forward a little bit more to last year. So last year, my dad actually had a health scare. And so he was also there when that happened. So I went to go visit him after I saw on Facebook that he was there. And he was like, oh, no, I only posted it after I left. And I was like, well, great. Like, I was going to come visit you, but you weren't there. But ever since that time, he's told me he's always been checking on me and my dad to make sure that both of us are okay. Even the last time I saw him, which was like November, December, the first thing he told me to do when I came and visited him was somebody had got him a stuffed Mario. And Michael was a little bit afraid of inanimate objects. So when he woke up, people kept, like, this Mario kept moving everywhere and, like, looking at him. And he would constantly tell the nurse, like, I purposely turned it away. Did you move it to, like, turn it back? And they're like, no. So, you know, even though he was a prankster, people knew that he could be pranked as well. So because of that, Michael's kind of taught me a lot of things to be brave and be risky. And also sometimes it's okay to do stupid things because you never know, maybe the pineapple and anchovy pizza might work. Thank you.
In the days to come, the weeks and months, and when life starts to settle back to its somewhat normalcy, we think about the family and remember Michael. Send him a text, send him an email. I hear Hallmark is still in business, so send him a card, maybe. But let's keep his memory alive.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you to all who have shared of yourself about Michael this evening. I'm sure Big Mac Daddy is be up there and he's looking down and says, I didn't know I was that good. From the time Michael was born, Michael had to struggle with life. He had to struggle to survive, to exist in a world that would challenge his very existence. But from that beginning, Big Mac Daddy was an example to all of us to have that strength and determination to carry on a filled life. But not just fill his life, he filled it with joy. He filled it with ambition. He filled it with excitement. But not just for himself, he did that for others. He included you in his world. He didn't expect you to include him in your world. Michael was an example of God's grace to challenge this young man in life to show that suffering was not a deterrent to life. If you're familiar with the scriptures, it is said that in order to live like Christ is to suffer like Christ. And in 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, we see these words. What is love? Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Sound familiar? Sound like Big Mac Daddy to me. He was an inspiration to empower confidence in yourself, in your ability to endure all things. Suzanne was sharing with me the other day was that she'd received some Facebook messages, people wishing well to the family and expressing their emotions. And one of Michael's friends posted, particularly stood out to me, that described Michael. Three words: light, laughter, and love. Light in that just as Christ was a light to all of us in a point of darkness, Michael was that life light to many of you in your life. Laughter. Well, who can't resist the laugh of being a gassy personality? Or giving the love all salute. But see, that was part of him. That was his expression. The scripture referred to in 1 Corinthians in the last few words says these, and now faith, hope, and love abide. Faith, hope, and love abide. And the greatest of these is love. Isn't that what it all sums up for Michael? Is his love? Michael's life was impaired with the inability to breathe, as many of us can, but there was nothing that would dampen Michael's life and spirit to fill that life to the fullest. I heard the story about him driving his ninja motorcycle across country from Texas to California all by himself. There are many of us that would be challenged to navigate a bicycle around our neighborhood, but he went all the way from here to California. Skydiving solo without a tandem jumper. They had to weight his waist with weights because he was so light that he might just be floating in the air. Well, I tried that once as a tandem jumper. Let me tell you, I screamed like a little boy. So he showed that courage. See, Michael had that courage to face fate and be unafraid, because in the scriptures, I really believe that we heard in Psalm, God is with me, his rod and thy staff, they comfort me. They led him down through the valleys, the shadow of death, and he felt no evil, because Michael understood that all he had to do was look up to the light. Michael was that light for many of us. You see, I really feel that on that day, Michael defeated death. He defeated death. He won the victory. For him, as it is said in Corinthians, where, O death, is your sting? Where, O death, is your victory? There is no more pain. There is no more suffering. He's breathing fresh air. He's gone home. I suggest to you that the way Big Daddy, Big Mac Daddy, lived his life, that on that morning when he opened up his eyes, there he saw the presence of Jesus Christ with his arms wide open, accepting him into that heavenly home not made by hands, telling him, well done, my true and trusted servant. Welcome home. Welcome home. Michael was that giving spirit that would do anything that he could to brighten your day. He made you smile when you were sad. Michael made you laugh when there was no chance to get even a chuckle out of you. He fought his condition courageously without complaints or self-pity. Michael showed us the way to live. Michael would give you all he had, and when he had nothing more, he would find a way to give you more. I understand that a few days before he passed away, that he was on an app or an internet, and he was contributing to someone else in need. During his last hours, Michael was ensuring that the final steps taken so that Suzanne would be ensured to keep on the cellular phone service and texting, I think, with Jason, just to make sure that these were taken care of. Michael loved his Patrick the cat. And as I understand it, he's taking his buddy Stuart the dog with him. Michael leaves us one more message in death with this following scripture, and it comes from 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8. I ask you to listen to this. It says, as for me, I'm being poured out as an offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And here's where we see Michael receiving the grace of God, but he also, in his giving way, tells us back with these final words of that scripture. And it says, and not only to me, but also to all who long for his appearing. As we walk into this journey that we call life, we take Michael's spirit with us. His tenacity to work, his love of recreation, but most of all, that infectious smile and that cheery attitude that he gave of himself and his family to his family first. The spirit that lived within Michael was never self-regarding. Michael always thought first of his loved ones before he thought of himself. Now, Michael kept his passions honestly and openly for all to see. There is no doubt about that. But at the end of the day, he loved God. He loved his family. he loved you. The love, the spirit, and the life of Michael lives on in all of us in this room. Pass that on so that Michael's spirit never dies. Let us pray. Eternal God, you have shared with us the life of Michael. Before he was ours, and now he is yours. For all that Michael has given us to make us what we are, for that of him which lives and grows in each of us, and for his life that in your love will never end, we give you thanks. And now, as we offer Michael back into your arms, comfort us in our loneliness, strengthen us in our weakness, and give us courage to face that future unafraid. Draw those of us who remain in this life closer to one another. Make us faithful to serve one another and lead us to know peace and joy through Jesus Christ our Lord. And with the confidence of your people, together we pray this unending prayer, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I've done everything.